So, this is our last class on the neuron. I will quickly recapitulate. The mathematical description of the neuron. So, talking about the active part of the neuron, and we will be starting quickly in a mini review from the Hodgkin-Huxley equation that that describe dv to dt equal, and now we had here with the C in front, we had here then our currents through the voltage gated channels, and the gating came around through variables N and M and H, and we realized that those two dependencies on N could be eliminated, and we only need the dependence on N, and that makes it a two-dimensional equation, and this two-dimensional equation lives in a pretty flat manifold. So this is coordinated by V and N, and so we can focus on this particular manifold. And we want to understand the key behavior of the system, namely the threshold behavior and what I like to call digital response, a signal that is just a response when we get above the threshold that is very deterministic and always more or less the same. And so we stated already that we are looking at the slow dynamics of the system, and that is stated by looking at dv to dt equals zero, where the dynamic would actually be totally zero in terms of v, and near that curve we have slowness, and that curve looks like this. And then we have also a curve characterized to n dot equals zero, and that curve looks like this, and that other curve looks like this. So this is this curve, and this is this curve. And so those are the critical elements that determine how actually the solution of the Hodgkin-Huxley equation behaves. And so now we want to simplify it by now taking a differential equation that has a similar slow behavior. And so, but that is easier to discuss, particularly in the classroom. And this equation that reproduces nicely equation, the key behavior of the Hodgkin-Huggs equation is called the Fitzhugh-Nagumo equation, and I introduced it, and it has two variables, one x, which is corresponds to v, and one variable y that corresponds to m. And this equation reads as follows. We have x1 dot is equal to c times x2 plus x1 minus x1 cubed over 3 plus z, where z is a variable that describes a constant stimulation of the system, and we will discuss a little bit how that enters into the final solution. And then we have x2 dot is equal to 1 over c times a minus x1 minus b x2. And then we said that we wanted to choose a is equal to 0.7, b is equal to 0.8, c is equal to 3, just to be specific. We don't give units because we are interested in the qualitative behavior. We are not relating it to some real time scale or to some real voltage amplitude. And now if we are looking then at x1 dot equals 0, then we are getting an equation here that reads like x2 is equal to x1 cubed over 3 minus x1 minus z. And if we plot this, then we find the behavior of the Hodgkin-Huxley, except for some reason that people in the Fitzhugh-Nagumo equation give x1 the opposite sign. And so if we plot this, then we are getting a cubic curve that corresponds sort of to the key element in the Hodgkin-Huxley equation, except the parabola goes, the third order polynomial goes in this direction. And if we then look at x2 dot, then for this one is this. And if you look at x2 dot equals 0, then we are led to the equation x2 is equal to a over b minus 1 over b x1. And that's a linear equation with a negative slope, since b is 0.6, and so we're getting something like this. Now the v is the z enters here and it lifts the third order polynomial. And now I didn't draw it very nicely. How can I? So I just didn't draw it nicely. I don't even know how to redraw it now to get the proper cut there. So I think I need to redraw it a little bit. I redraw this one a little steeper. I have to redraw it totally differently. So it's all correct, sometimes you draw it in a stupid way and sometimes you draw it in a smart way. And so here we are getting an equation that looks like this. I draw this linear one like this. And now you see that if you are moving the third order polynomial up and down. Then if you move it down, you're cutting through here. If you move it up, you will cut with this line through the middle of it, and so on. So you are shifting the point where the two cut across a parabola with D. This depends on D. Okay, then what we did then already last time is we considered actually the point that x1 dot as well as x2 dot is zero. So then both equations hold, and in this case we get then, you know, two equations, two unknowns. We are getting now a single point here, where both of them are zero. On this point we call x1 stationary and x2 stationary. And when we place the system there, there will be no dynamics. And if we are now saying let's write x1 as x1 stationary plus delta x1, and x2 as x2 stationary plus delta x2, then we can expand in terms of delta x1 and x2, and we are getting then an equation that reads delta x1 dot and delta x2 dot. And then if we do a little algebra, which is what you do for your homework, I posted the homework and today, then you find here an equation that reads, let me quickly give it to you, reads like C times 1 minus x1 stationary squared, and then c, and here minus 1 over c, and minus b over c, and then here we have delta x1 and delta x2, plus order of delta, so this is to linear order. So keep only the linear terms. Okay, so this is equation, and now we stated that one can describe the solution around this point, and one does it by calling this matrix M, and one looks at the eigenvectors of M, V1 and 2 equal lambda 1, 2 times V1, comma 2, and the eigenvalues lambda 1, 2 are given by the trace of M divided by 2 plus minus square root of the trace of M divided by 2 squared minus the determinant of M. I checked it now, this is what you get. And so, very straightforward to calculate. And now, you can then expand the solution, delta x1 of t and delta x2 of t. So you can write it now, you can expand it now in terms of C1, V1 e to the lambda 1 t plus C2, V2 e to the lambda 2 t. And at t equals 0, we have then C1, V1 plus C2, V2 is a delta x1 0, delta x2 0. Let's call this one for the moment alpha 0. So this is known. You know, we need to know where we are at the beginning. Of course, when we want to find, when we want to plot a solution, and so we know this one, and now we can write this one as V11 and V21 and V12 and V22 times C1 C2 is equal to alpha 0, and this is these are the coefficients of the eigenvectors, so they are known. We solve the eigenvalue problem, and so we are getting then, if I'm not making too many mistakes, C1, C2, I write the inverse of this matrix, and it is V11, V22, minus V12, V21, the determinant, times the matrix V22, V11, minus V21, and minus V12. And acting on the unknown, on alpha 0. And so you can calculate your C1 and C2s. And then you can describe them. Now this matrix M is not symmetric. And so the eigenvectors are not orthogonal then. So you have eigenvectors, no problem. But from quantum physics, we have symmetric or self-adjoint matrices. And here we have a non-symmetric C3 and minus 1 over 3. That's clearly non-symmetric. And so we cannot expect that we have this simple behavior. And the behavior we get is determined now by the eigenvalues. And if we have the case that lambda 1, 2 are real, that the right is if our radicand here is larger than 0, then we're getting two real eigenvalues. And and now we have then the case that lambda 1 and lambda 2 might both be negative, then we see that the solution here shrinks to 0, means it goes to the stationary point. And if these are here our the directions given by V1 and V2, I draw them purposefully not orthogonal, because in general they're not orthogonal, then the components C1 and C2 move this way along the eigenvectors, and if we have a mixture of the two, then depends on which eigenvalue is more negative than the other. You might go more like this, or you might go more like this. Depends on the actual numerical value. And if you have a mixture that lambda 1 is smaller 0 and lambda 2 is larger 0, then we have what we call the saddle point, that we have in the L2 direction we spread out, and in the L1 direction, in the V1 direction we go together. And if we have lambda 1 and lambda 2 both equal larger 0, then we're getting the behavior that should be clear to you now, that we are spreading away from the stationary point. So this is always a stationary point. Okay, so this is what you can get, but we can also get a behavior where the radicand here is negative, and then we're getting here an imaginary contribution, so then the eigenvalues are complex, and then we have lambda 1, 2 complex, and in this case you see that the eigenvalues have the form lambda 1, 2 is equal to gamma, I have delta already, mu plus minus I nu, where mu and nu are real.
Oh, we're getting a conjugate complex pair of eigenvalues, and now if we have that mu is smaller there, then when we solve near the stationary point, then we find a spiral that goes into the stationary point. And that is sort of, as I told you, clear when you look, for example, a typical case of a solution where we have plus I omega t plus 1/2 1 minus I e to the minus I omega t. So it's a pure, it's a simple case where the real is zero. So we just have the conjugate complex imaginary component, and this is just a circle motion, it's just cosine omega t and minus sine omega t, and this is a circle motion. So then we would be on a circle, we would don't have a real part shrinking it, but if we then have in addition a real part shrinking it, then it's clear that we are just behaving like this. So this would be the direction here. And we can also have the opposite. So we have this direction. And if we have mu larger zero, then we have the same story, but we now spiral out of this situation. So this one you call there are all names for it. Names don't mean anything. So let's just say these are the situations that we expect. Okay, so this is the local behavior around the stationary point. So here we are looking at local near x stationary. Okay, so now we want to go to the global behavior, and there I told you that we have a different problem to solve. Now it turns out that here is where we are getting all the interesting biology, also the interesting mathematics, but also the interesting biology. And so I told you that if we have here our solution space, x1 and x2, then a solution like this are we have two solution trajectories like this. That is not possible. So the solutions do not cross. So the solutions are forming, like I told you, spaghetti on a plate, and they cannot cross. And then I also told you, when you look at solutions very far away from the stationary point, you find that you're getting, in general, a shrinkage towards the stationary point when you are far away. But you see that you have these kind of possibilities. You can have the real part of the conjugate complex eigenvalues is positive, or both real eigenvalues are positive, and then you are moving away from the stationary point on one side, and you are moving towards the stationary point from far away, so there must be somewhere a compromise in the middle. And how that looks like, one can do by numerical experiment. So global behavior seen in numerical experiment. And that is what you have to also do in your homework. And so you plot now your solutions for two cases, one time for z equals 0, and one for z equals minus 0.4. So since I gave A, B, and C in real units with real quantities, it's now also reasonable to give a very specific value for z. And so if you go first to z equals 0, then you will find when you do your solutions, that you can plot this parabola, And then the parabola there is really itself not emerging in the solutions, but almost. You find a line near here, you find a line near here, and you find a line near here that really are very characteristic for the solution. So here I should draw like this. So this is a stationary point here. So here. So you find these lines. And these lines show only up when you actually do numerical solution. The way you do the numerical solution is you take x and expand it in, you add the time increment dt, and then you do a Taylor expansion in dt, and what you're getting then is this is x of t plus dt times f of x, where f 1 is c x2 plus x1 minus x1 cubed over 3 plus v. You see that I don't make a error. Yes, that's what it is. And then x2, f2 is 1 over c times a minus x1 minus b x2. We see one right there. Or is it plus x1? No, it's correct. Okay, good. That's what you get. Those are the components of f. And so you take this one at the value t, and that is your local force that moves the trajectory. And so this is what you get. You write it as the first component, x1 is equal, and x2 is equal. So you're getting this one. And so you can construct very quickly the solution, and you can experiment, but if you take dt is equal to 0.01, you're on the safe side. Your Taylor expansion is converging well. Second order terms do not contribute much. You're getting numerically a stable solution as long as you hang around the stationary points. And now, if you now plot the solution, and you start at many, many places, then you find that the solutions, now I just draw them as thin lines, so a thin line, you find the solution, go like this, and then go here, then they go spout out here, and spout in, stop. If you go here, they go like this, spout. You go like here. So here they all do the same. If you come here, they go to this line. If you come here, they go to this line. If you come here, they go to this line. If you come here, they go to this line. And if you come from here, you go to this line, to this line, to this line. If you go here, you go straight and like this, and so on. And now if you go here, to this line, you actually go away. Here you are going away. So you go quickly away and quickly away. And so here you have a ridge. And here you have a valley. But it's sort of like a mean valley. The valley ends in a waterfall. So it's one of those nightmares when you're in the mountains, then it ends in a waterfall, solution goes straight out, then you go into the next valley, and that catches you in the stationary point. But this one here actually goes a little bit below here, sort of. I draw it like this. Okay, good. And so now, if we take z equal minus 0.5, then we again have our parabola. And now it turns out that our stationary point is here. I discussed that already. And now you're getting then the following behavior. You're getting again these lines. And here getting a ridge line. And now you're going, solutions are just like this. The solutions, for the solutions, it looks almost the same. If you plot many solutions, they look all very different. But when you come out here, you have another waterfall, you go here by like this. And so now if you are taking many solutions, what you end up with any solution is, you end up with any solution at the end. So let's go here, we go like here, and then we go like here, and then we go here like this, around and around. You end up in a limit, in a what is called a limit cycle. So at the end you go infinitely around. So really dramatic different behavior from the other case, even though the solution locally look very similar. So that is how it goes. And now we find that these valleys and ridges are really very important for the biological function. So for example, let's go here, which is actually usually the normal quote case in biology, that you have a stable stationary point. Whenever we excite a neuron, it decays back to a stationary state. And so if we are here, we stay here. Now if we are moving a little bit away, we look at our linear expansion, we are going back more or less either around, depends on if we have complex eigenvalues or real eigenvalues, or more or less straight, but I don't know how to do this, but here we are getting this kind of behavior that relaxes more or less straight back to the stationary point. So we're getting relaxation. But if we are going now with our solution beyond this line, so here we are getting also, when we go here we are also getting, takes a little longer the relaxation, but more or less we go quickly back. But when we are going now across the line here, then the solution goes like this and makes the standard course and ends up here. So this one is crossing the threshold. And at that moment, we are going out and around. And so these sort of features that determine the threshold behavior, they don't depend much on Z. And you know, no matter where you end up, you are going to this valley, you are spouted out into this valley, you end. And so if you plot this one, then it's sort of just the opposite to the physiological behavior. You are starting here, let's say, with this value, you're becoming negative, you're going positive, and you're going like this. So here is very quick, you go here very quick negative, and then you go through a minimum, then you go very quick positive, and then you slowly return to the stationary value. And here might be the threshold. And so then here maybe the stationary value would be, didn't draw it very nicely, so it would be like this. And so now we are, this is the threshold, and the stationary point is of course above the threshold here, so this is a stationary potential here, and x1 stationary, and that's where you end up. So this one is x1 of t. And so the so once you go below, you if you would go just a little below, you return a little more below. So if I draw this one in large, then we're getting this behavior here. We have here x1 stationary, x threshold, x1 threshold. And now if we are going here, here we stay. Here, if we go here, we return. Here we return. Here we return. And here we are going negative, positive, and go right. And if we go further down, not a big change. Not a big change, always the same signal. So we see that we are getting really the biological behavior from the global pattern rather than the local pattern. And that is what we need to understand now. Okay, so now we have to now understand these, I like to call those singular lines, the lines that form the valleys and the ridge. And we want to characterize them. And to do this, we proceed as follows. We realize that one of them is near the line x1 dot equals 0. So let's maybe start with this. So x1 dot equals 0, the x1 dot equals 0 line, gave rise to the third order polynomial. And the solution, the third order polynomial, go like this. If we have here our thing, then the solutions go like this. So here was this line. The line is now invisible, but they go like this. This is x1. X1 dot is 0 on this line, so they go straight up. With other words, this is a line. This is a line with m of trajectory goes to infinity. M is a slope, so they have infinite slope. Now if we go to this line here, here we have this behavior. Here we have x1, x2 dot is equal to 0, so they go horizontal. X2 is not changing. So this line here is corresponds to trajectory, m trajectory equal 0. And so now we may ask the following question. We may ask, where is m trajectory equal to? So we ask equal 0, we ask equal 1. Why not ask equal 2? And so you can try it experimentally by just, you know, you will find it's not easy to find it actually. So it's not trivial to determine this. You will see in a second also why. But you find, for example, here a curve. Maybe I just draw it here like this, where here we have everywhere on those points an m value for the trajectory point that goes through this line. So there's a line with m equal 2, so we call this one x2 is equal to a function of x1 where m is equal to. So this is how we would write it. Whereas this one here was a line where x2 is I of x1 infinite. and here we have a line x2 is equal I of x1 0. So now it's not clear that that gets us closer to our territory, but yes it does, because now we are looking at the following. Now we first we want to determine how do we do this calculation. So if we want, in general, we want to find the line x2 is equal to I of x1 m for any m. So we do this. Let's say we do it, the way we do that is as follows, that we're getting this one from solving f2 of x1, x2, f1 and f2 are defined there, divided by f1 of x1 and x2. So this is equal, minus m is equal zero, we solve this equation. So the f2 and f1 define the trajectory direction, and thereby they define the slope of the trajectory. So if you look here, then the trajectory will go in the direction of f1 in the x1 direction, and by an amount f1 in the x1, and by an amount f2 in the two direction. And in general, if we want to look, we want to see where do trajectories have a slope m, then we know that f2 over f1 has to be m, or we have this implicit equation. And if we solve this, this is actually only an implicit equation. We cannot really write down, you know, from this one, look at it and quickly write x2 is equal. That sometimes you may be able to do it, but in general not. So you have an equation that you sort of implicitly know. Now, the existence of this solution I don't want to go into that, it's actually not that that complicated, but you can look it up for yourself, is given by the implicit function theorem. The implicit function theorem tells you under which conditions you can get the solution. And it also tells you a very important property of the solution that we are going to use in a second. So we have this implicit function that tells you, oh, if this and this is true, then don't worry, you can get the solution. Okay, so this is what we have. Okay, now let's look at our curve I of x1 m equal x2. So this is the x2, x1, and we want to look at one of these curves. And here we have a curve, a similar curve, and here we have a similar curve. This one here is I of x1 m plus d plus delta. Delta is positive. And here the curve with I of x1 m minus delta. Delta is positive, so this is, so if we have here now this kind of slope, and here we have this kind of slope, here a little higher, and you know, we know that then we can ask, oh, where do we have the slope m? And we might now see a situation that the slope m, you see this is a little curve, so what I draw you cannot be literally be true, but that curve I of x1 m has pretty much itself the slope m. And the one below have a higher slope, the one above have a lower slope. They must converge to it, because those guys that where this one has a slope m, they will stay on it. And those are the singular lines. So this line, this situation, there we're getting a stable singular line characterized to x2 through that the derivative of this one, of this guy, d1 of I of x1 m, is m. Now, this is actually the problem, that if you look at it, you say, oh, this is a function of two variables. And so we can get a derivative contribution not only from this explicit x1 dependent, but also from the m dependent. So we must also write dm of I of x1 and m times dm to dx1. But what you find is, I don't want to say often, but you find is that this is often, I use the word often, this can be small. So this can be really a total screw up, but it can also be small. So then basically you have this one plus a little decoration. And so this would be now the situation here. So this one would correspond to a valley. So if we have a line that is characterized through this and has the higher m value curve below and the lower m value curve above, then we are getting a convergence into the valley. So we see really how the trajectory is moving. Now if we are getting, if we are now looking at the other way around, we can also have that the curves, the neighboring curves are oppositely aligned. So now let's say we have here our one where we have approximately m is equal to d1 I of x1 m. And now we have the other guys like this. This is I of x1 m plus delta. Here is I of x1 and m minus delta. Then here we have a lower, and here we have a higher m. And so here the things go away from this line. So this corresponds to a ridge. So we see that we are getting the two solutions. Okay, but now the problem is that we need to find those lines. That's our problem. And there's actually a solution. And so we look at our baby here. We're looking at this equation m. And then we have here this to take. But now we realize that we have d1 of f2 divided by f1. That's what our I is. And so now we know how to take the derivative here. If we take the derivative here, we are getting so prime. Okay, good. So we're getting d1 f2 times 1 over f1. That's from here. Minus f2 and then df1 divided by f1 squared. So this is the derivative of 1 over f1. And similarly, we get here d1 f1 this is what we get. Sorry. What am I doing here? Which is what we get? But I My mistake. Woo! Sorry, forget everything the professor said up to this point. So now we have the implicit function theorem. The implicit function theorem tells us now that this m is equal to minus, no, I want to really look it up, but I don't screw that up. So the implicit function tells us what this derivative is. So what I wrote here is good, but that doesn't help you much. So the implicit function theorem tells you that this one is minus d1 of f2 over f1 divided by d2 of f2 over f1. So this is not intuitive. So you can go, you Google implicit function theorem, you find derivations in the wiki. But it's not a trivial derivation, but it's also not out of this world. It's like what you learn in differential equation theory and stuff. So it would be like about half an hour derivation I would have to give you. But you can take my word for it. If you look there, you find this is a right statement. It tells you what this derivative is. And now, if we do this, then we find that we're getting here minus, and then we have here d1 f2 times 1 over f1 minus d f2 d1 f1 over f1 squared divided by d2 f2 times 1 over f1 minus f2 d2 f1 over f1 squared. So now we multiply the numerator and the denominator by f1 so that we get rid of this stuff. And then the equation reads minus d1 f1 f2 minus, and now we have here f1 f2 over f1. So now let me, forgive me that I'm doing this step as one. Immediately an f2 over f1 is of course our m. Yeah, so that is how m has been defined originally. Our implicit equation is that we have f2 of f1 is a slope of our trajectory. That was the definition. And so then we have here d1 of f1, and then divided by d2 f2 minus m d, d1 minus m f1 d2 f1. Okay, now I can switch the sign here and put the m term to the front, and this comes with a minus sign, and then I multiply it with the denominator, and so maybe write it quickly. So I'm writing minus d m d1 f1 minus d1 f2 divided by m d2 f1 minus d2 f2. And so now from this I multiply, I'm getting then the following equation: m squared times d2 f1, and then I'm getting minus this, but I rather take this one which is negative and put it first. Then getting plus m times d1 f1, and from this one here I'm getting minus d2 f2, and then okay, good, and then I have So this one, I'm getting an M squared term, an M term, and then I have this one left, which is here minus plus, but then on the other side is minus. So minus minus, so now this one, so with this term left, it's plus and minus d1 f2. Okay, good. And so I brought everything on the left side, and on the right side is zero. And so what I have is here a quadratic equation. And I can have solutions, they are real and complex. Now, when I'm getting real solutions, I'm happy because that can be a slope. So then it's reasonable solution, very good. If it's a complex solution, no, it cannot be a slope because f2 is real, f1 is real, f2 over f1 is real, m is real. So complex means there's no solution. And so, okay, good. So then you would expect everywhere, except at certain places where you have windows, where the M tries to be complex, where you have two solutions. But now we have to have the consistency condition that these guys have to be small. And so now when you look at it, then you find now of the two solutions, one makes it large, the other one is small. And so then when you look at you're solving this equation for different x1 values, then you find you get a solution here, you get a solution here, you're getting a solution here. And so basically this is sort of how it looks like. Here are windows where you don't get a solution, and there are complex values, and you only get one solution, other solution doesn't obey the consistency condition. And so now you see that you can identify these lines, you see that they can exist, and now you really see now very beautifully that if this one is a stationary point, that you are getting here relaxation behavior, and here you're getting all with the same signal behavior. And so let me draw this one real fat again, this one real fat again, and here real fat, the ridge, and that you call also the separatrix, because it separates the two solution behaviors, and so you really see how the system behaves. And so that is the mathematics behind this threshold behavior. That is, at the same time, also a signaling behavior. The signal always looks very, very similar, no matter how you cross the threshold. If you don't cross the threshold, go more or less quickly back. If you cross the threshold, you're zooming to the solution. And return then across those two valleys. They give you here the extreme voltage value here. They give you the extreme voltage value there. And so you see that evolution was pretty smart. It played with these things and it realized somehow that's how it goes. And it did it with sort of the Hodgkin-Huxley equation. That is sort of the basis. When we looked at it, we saw that the terms in the Hodgkin-Huxley equation are really reminiscent of the actual structure, the architecture of the ions, of the ion channels. And so there we really saw that, you know, even though these people wrote it down, the equation phenomenologically, that they captured actually the molecular basis of neural excitation. And then when we go, then we saw it's basically a two-dimensional equation, the way this was set up by the molecular system. Then we see that we can reproduce this by using sort of more an artistic mathematical stroke by using the Fitzy-Nagumo equation to sort of see how this kind of system behave. But the behavior is also what you see in the Hodgkin-Huxley equation, except that sort of numerically a little bit more complicated, and it's in the computer it's fine, but in the classroom not so fine. Okay, so this gives me 10 minutes for a very brief other chapter, where we talk about what you then do with the neuron when you compute. So here we have the neuron. I don't have the time to tell you that if you are solving here the Hodgkin-Huxley equation, you can now do the coupling to the neighbors. And when we did it in case of the passive elements, we got the cable equation that had, in addition to the decay dynamics, a diffusive term. And what we are going to get here is just a diffusive coupling term. You're getting a Hodgkin-Huxley equation here, Hodgkin-Huxley equation here and here, and they're coupled diffusively so that they always try to equal out. And so as a result, then you're getting a spread of the solution to the axon. And now if your signal came from here, so at this point here, so at this point in the cell, the cell body cannot be excited. Only the axon can be excited through the Hodgkin-Huxley equation, can be actively excited. So when you are here, you cannot get excited here. Doesn't work, no Hodgkin-Huxley equation, only there. So let's say somehow you believe me and we got here, then in this area of the solution, we go around the Hodgkin-Huxley equation, and we went through the threshold, and we are now in this territory here. And now when you are trying to excite it again, it's impossible. The first time you can excite the system is when you returned. Then you can get it over the threshold again. If you are trying to fluctuate here, and I think you are even asked to do that in your homework problem, you find, yes, the solution, you know, the behavior goes like this. So since we have a negative peak, I draw a negative peak, so it goes like this. But, you know, but it's stable in its shape. You know, you fluctuate around here a little bit, but you don't get any different behavior. The first time you're getting a different behavior, if you go around here, vroom, you go over there. So this one here, this behavior, you in this part of the system, until you are back at the stationary point, you call it a refractive period where you cannot do anything to the neuron. So this part of the axon where you had been active is in the refractive part of the Hodgkin-Huxley equation where you cannot do anything. It's dead. You know, it has to recuperate, get back to this side of the ridge before you can excite it again. Refractive, nothing you can do. So basically like you burn the territory and zero. But on this side, everything is fresh. Here you can excite. Here the guy's waiting, bored. Oh, I'm so bored. I hope I could get over the ridge. Oh, I'm getting a kick, and boom, they go. Where these guys are tired, they don't want to do anything. They are on this side, on the other side of the ridge. You cannot do much to them. And so you see you're getting a unidirectional signal. Also very, very elegant and also built in nicely into the behavior. Okay, so but then what do these neurons do? And so I give you two very, very quick examples. I can even do that in 5 minutes. And the first example is in the eye. In the eye, we have our eyes, and when you are reading, you have to look at the text. If you are telling me, oh, professor, I'm reading this book, and I see that your eyes are really looking above the book, or to the left, or to the right, I tell him, you're not reading. Because the only way to read the little letters is when you are looking straight onto the page. So you have a foveal area in the eye where you have many sensors that can resolve the fonts. So if you are, there's a book and you go like this, I know you are not reading. Because with this part of the eye, you can maybe see a truck coming and then you might avoid the truck driving over you, but you cannot see a letter. So the distribution, if this is an eye and here we have our retina, the distribution of the receptors is highest here. And the receptor distribution is given by 2 pi r along a circumference here. This is, this is r. Along the circumference is constant, but they decay with 1 over r squared. So 2 pi r goes, constant. You know, when you have a bigger circle, you expect, of course, more receptors. But then here you have the weighting, foveal more than peripheral. So when r becomes large, you get fewer. Okay, now you have to send this one to the brain. So if this one is here, I'm very bad in drawing. Try to draw a nose and an eye. So here's the eye. Here's a person. Then your optical cortex is in this area, where you are dealing with the signals here. And now you must send all these guys here so that you have a one-to-one relationship, where if you have one receptor, you have to have one address in the optical cortex. So the density to here has to be the same. If you integrate over all these guys, you must get the same value than when you integrate over these guys. That means that you have a map where you're mapping here to x and y. But dx dy has to be equal to the density, has to be equal to rho of r and zeta. And now you ask, what function gives you this that density? So that you are getting on the right side in the cortex the same density as you get on the other one. And the function is x of r is equal to logarithm 1 plus r. So x doesn't depend on theta. And y depends on r and theta and is given by r theta divided by 1 plus r. And if you now take the Jacobian, j is equal, now you take d r x, d r y, d theta x, d theta y, then you are getting rho of r, zeta drops out, and you're getting the density back. So this is the map that conserves the area, the number of neurons. Detail is a little different, but that's a simple one. And so now we send things back. We send information here. But when there's something wrong with our brain, then we have something happening here. We think that can come from our eyes. And so there is, for example, a case of migraine. In migraine, you are getting brain waves that are unusual. When you look at the brain, it's almost random. If you look at it, you think, oh, random noise. What kind of brain do you have? Yes, there is some real processing going on, but it looks very, very random. But when you have a disease state like migraine or epileptic seizures, then you are seeing patterns that are global. And one pattern that you can see in the optical cortex when you get migraine are stripes. Like this. And the stripes roll over the area, getting waves that go over the optical cortex like this. And now you think, these stripes, you see them, you think, they come from my eye, of course, because you know the brain is your thinker, and the brain usually gets it from the eye, and now suddenly the brain gets that, and it will interpret this, that it comes from the eye. And what you're getting now as an impression that you feel as a person is that you are falling into a tunnel, into a rotating tunnel, like a spiral. You fall down there because this spiral comes towards you when they move like this. When they move in the opposite direction like this, and you think you fall out of the tunnel. You go, or you go there. And so when you also, people are on drugs, they see also some strange things because they also get brain patterns that are more global and unusual. And the patterns they see are simply the inversions of these brain maps. Now what do have the neurons to do with the brain maps? The neurons are very, very flexible. Most of these brain maps you learn a lot when you are a baby, but also later. And I remember that I worked on this quite a bit about 20 to 10 years ago, and I had a collaboration with Harvard Medical School. Said, oh, I want to work with you. And they said, okay, good, Professor Schulden. Well, who are you? Oh, I'm a theoretical physicist. Yawn. And then, yeah, but I'm really interested. Okay, here are some data. What are they? Oh, these are from a monkey. The monkey is half a year old, and that's the map. We looked at the map, and we sent them back an email a few days later. We told them, sorry, that monkey is not a 6 month old, it's 3 month old. And that was true. And they realized we understood something. They would have not gone how we knew it, but we knew how this brain make themselves. And now I can just tell you with very few words, you're getting from the retina of the eye, you're getting through the dendritic tree, the so-called ganglion cells, the axons. They don't go straight to the optical cortex, but let's forget that for a moment. And now you have here the neurons in the optical cortex that connect to other neurons in the optical cortex and other brain areas. And now the dendrites of these, at the end of the axons, they make synapses. And these synapses that we drew always, like if this one is a dendrite of a neuron that has here the axon, these synapses can change. That's where the learning takes place. That's where your wiring of your brain takes place. That's where you're making the maps. And so you're choosing these synapses so that you're getting a good representation of the world. So this is how these neurons do it. The synapses that we talked about, where there's a connection point, they are adaptive in time. They shape over the lifetime, and they give the function. And one that I cannot tell you more, but it's sort of like a very cute one, is a bat. A bat is sending out a sound signal. And if there is a fly in the night air, it reflects the sound signal, and you're getting then a frequency shift in the ears of the bat that goes like 2 velocity bat minus over velocity of sound divided minus velocity of prey, insect, whatever, divided by the velocity of sound. This is a Doppler shift. And now you see they can see there is no prey, this term is not there. If the prey is not moving, they cannot see, but if the prey is moving, they're getting a Doppler shift. And the shift, the shift is they have a frequency of kilohertz, 61 kilohertz, where they do their sound. They go like ee! And every bat has their own sound. Like if we are two bats here, and let's say we happen to have both 61, then we move away from each other. You go a little bit down, and I go a little bit up, so that we don't interfere too much, so that we can all. And now they have the Doppler shift is very, very small relative to the whole frequency range that a fly can hear, that a bat can hear. So they need extreme sensitivity in this very small window. And so what they are doing now is they are taking most of their auditory neurons in their auditory brain, the auditory context, devoted to 61 kilohertz. So they have very few neurons here, millions of them here, very few here. So that they can really resolve there. So they have a foveal area like we in our eyes. They have a foveal area around the frequency where they try to catch their prey, where they have then many, many neurons. And that is a learned behavior. Every bat depends on what population they come from. They hear everybody in the family singing, so they start to sing. And they don't know yet why, because the mother feeds them the insects. But then later they realize that they hear the sound change, and then they sing and sing and sing and listen and listen and listen. And this is being an extreme adaptation of the brain, where the brain devotes all of these neurons to this, because the neurons that come from that area are connecting themselves to the brain in such a way that there is a redistribution of sensitivity going on. And that happens when you learn to play tennis, with skiing, when you learn physics, language. You are basically rewiring constantly your brain at the level of the synapses. And so this is why, sort of how the neurons really do much of their learning. They have the ability of a threshold behavior of generating signals. And then at the synapse, they can transmit the signals, but in a fashion that is adaptive, that can really change over lifetime. And that is really very much on a stamp, the physics of not only the neuron, but even of the brain. Okay, so I posed the problem that this is actually my last class with you. On Thursday, Tiki Pa will take over, and so I wish you much fun there. We will be available to you, of course. We will pick up the problem set from here on next Tuesday, and hope we're getting them all graded very quickly. And I'm always available to you for any questions you have. You can always knock on my door, send an email, and then you will also get one final problem in the take-home final that will be contributed from the first part of the class. Okay, so very nice seeing you twice a week, and wish you much success with the rest of the class and with your studies.